Hello, welcome to Vox Femme, to the Vox Femme 2021 Festival number 2. I'm Annette D'Armada.
I'm Lourdes Perez.
And our interpreter of American Sign Language today is Jenny Blake. I want to welcome her as well.
Welcome.
And we also want to give thanks to Ishel Cuellar, who is is helping us, our technical director, helping on social media. And we thank you all for being here. So we're not going to talk very much about Vox Femme or the festival. When we were planning this in these very kind of difficult times, we realized that starting this festival today, we needed to begin by remembering. And one of the things we do with Vox Femme is we feature women singer-songwriters, artists, and change makers, social justice activists from every nation and occupied territory on earth. And we've lost many of those elders, many of those women in the past year, and we decided we were going to begin by remembering them. We won't have all of them there today, but every woman that we honor today, we have created a space of remembrance on voxfem.org, and we welcome your contributions, your suggestions for that space.
Yes, thank you for being with us. It is actually indeed a very emotional time for us and exciting because those who have walked before us have given up the gift of remembering and have opened doors for us, have busted areas and spaces that were impossible to be envisioned before. So we honor them today and we thank you for being with us.
So we are going to start, with a woman who is very close to home. The first woman that we want to honor and who all of these women, you know, it's interesting. We started off by wanting to feature and connect women singer-songwriters and artists. And then we also said it needs to be these women who don't consider themselves artists, but their work, their life is a work of art. Their entire life is a work of art. And Brian is good. And Isabel Casillas Sanchez is one of those people. Many times these women, they may be known in their community. They may not be famous. You may not have heard of them. And yet their impact is far and wide. And that will be true with all of these women, whether you've heard of them or not. Their impact is immeasurable because it's like a stone in the water and the ripples just keep going. Isabel Sanchez was beloved. She was unconditionally loving, tradition-bearing, revolutionary, iconic, tiny, giant, storytelling, dancing woman. We will miss her for as long as we live. Isabel Sanchez, there's no way to describe the light that you were and will continue to be. Isabel Sanchez, presente.
Isabel Sanchez, she adopted us. We never left. She never left either. Flores rosadas, margaritas, conversaciones de paz, parecía no haber prisa en tu andar, tu magia, hacer que todo se viera tan fácil, una sonrisa generosa, una palabra firme, sin temer a los demagogos, intocables domingos con los tuyos, te compartiste en grande y dispersa entre todos, resuelta a seguir en baile eterno, aquí resides, madre.
And The space is on voxfem.org, and you can go to Changemakers, and there's a drop down list, and she will be there always. And there is also a link to a very beautiful La Voz de Esperanza, which is a magazine of the organization that she helped to found in San Antonio, Texas, and that edition is dedicated to her. And we are going to hear from two things we're going to do. For everyone, we tried to find a little piece where you hear the woman in their own words, a little piece of them. For some people, I know it may be difficult and hard, so I'm letting you know that we will be hearing from the women themselves. And then for each one, we tried to also find a way to give you a link if you want to help continue their legacy. In her case, there's so many things, but there's a link there for the Sanchez Fuentes Scholarship Fund. She went to Lanier High School, and she, for many, many years, raised money and established a fund to help the children from one of the lowest income areas of San Antonio, a traditional Mexican historic neighborhood where a lot of musicians come from, the west side of San Antonio. A scholarship to buy books for those children. So that is also there, the Sanchez Fuentes Scholarship Fund. Okay, now if you would talk for a second, give me a minute to put this up here.
Prepare.
Yes.
Anywhere that you went to a social gathering or a political gathering, there was Isabel with Enrique, a life of generosity and beauty, and just unconditional love, and just we will remember that forever. I think she would call and said, "When was the last time you talked to your mother?" I'm like, "Oh, maybe 2 weeks ago." She said, "I talked to her," and she said, "You haven't called her yet." And she will talk to anybody who will listen to her to advance them, to make them think, to become a better person. And she was not like having intended to do that, like such, like, you know, with that force. She just will just smile and just say whatever she was gonna say to any politician, anybody in city council, anybody.
Michelle, she was not afraid. Is that good?
Yes.
He gave them the job of breaking the pecans. And so my brother would, at the beginning, put his fingers in there. And so when he got home, his fingers were all full of blood and swollen and all that, until he learned how to do it better. But that's, you know, one thing that I always remember, his hands.
Community security, yeah, that's what the dogs are. Try to do door-to-door knocking, voter registration, whatever, you got to deal with the dogs.
Somebody had a birthday party, and that party went all night, and nobody complained. Nobody called the cops. It was a village. It was a place where the women ruled.
In the summer, everybody went out with their children. The children were running all around. And at a certain time, and it still happens around 10 o'clock, you feel a breeze. And so at that time, somebody would say, "Thank God," you know. And then after a while, it's the, "Buenas noches," you know, "Good night." Oh, hush.
Then the moment of victory, a Mexican orchestra played. When CIO organizer J. Austin Beasley asked how many had gone to jail, 1,000 hands went up. Isabel said at the Tardeada, "We used to shell pecans, and now we dance."
To join together and do a victory over the most powerful people in town, to have the union recognized, to shut down this industry, they're bound to have felt their power, the important things that they had done. In spite of the fact that they mechanized the industry afterwards, these workers lost their jobs, but that's the way capitalism works. We constantly need to fight for each new victory, you know? It's a never-ending struggle, but we will win, and someday we'll have a working class in power, political power, and someday we'll have socialism. That's...
In June 1938, the first minimum wage came in and Seligman mechanized. Relief lines formed outside of what had been Hueserías. When the Second World War began, Tejanos helped develop the economy that would fight the fascists, and some became warriors in defense of a nation that should have been their own.
And that that was a piece by Anne Lewis from A Strike and an Uprising also. So thank you.
Thank you.
And I want to make sure that we can see the interpreter. Okay, so we had a message that we need to make sure that we can see the interpreter, Jenny. So if you would give us one moment, we're going to make sure that she is spotlighted. Okay, Isha, can we see her now?
Yes, I can see her.
Okay, great, great. We got you back, Jenny. Okay, so then, the next woman warrior that we want to spotlight is Haunani K. Trask, and I'll do this quote.
Haunani K. Trask, a scholar, speaker, author, poet, and a warrior for the sovereignty for Native Hawaiian people, died on July 3rd. She was 71 years old. In her book, Notes from a Native Daughter, Colonialism and Sovereignty in Hawaii, Dr. Trask called Hawaii once the most fragile and precious of sacred places, now transformed by the American behemoth into a dying land. Only a whispering spirit remains, she wrote. Dr. Trask was unapologetic in holding solid Native Hawaiian non-negotiable sovereignty of their land. We will hear her in her own voice. Her sister and comrade, Mililani Trask, posted the final poem of Haunani K. Trask's book, Night is a Shark Skin Drum, telling us the poem begins with the words that tell us where she was going. Into our seaweed clouds and salt warm seabirds. Haunani K. Trask.
Here on the space that is shared for her, we have, we're going to hear her in her own words. There is also an article written about her by Anne Kalea, Keala Kelly, and there is another interview of hers.
We are not American! We are not American! We are not American. We are not American. Say it in your heart. Say it when you sleep. We are not American. We will die as Hawaiians. We will never be Americans. The Americans, my people, are our enemies. And you must understand that. They are our enemies. They took our land. They imprisoned our queen. They banned our language. They forcibly made us a colony of the United States. America always says they are democratic. Lies! That is a lie! They have never been democratic with Native people. They have never been democratic with Indians. They have never been democratic with Hawaiians. Woo! The United States of America is the most powerful imperialist country in the world. In the world. They control the United Nations. They control the Pacific Ocean. All these nuclear submarines circulating throughout the Pacific. The United States of America is a death country. It gives death to Native people. And the only way to fight the United States of America is to be political. Kuhe! 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 Fight! Fight! Fight!
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Lieutenant. Okay, trust.
We have here, I want to, and I believe you're still in the Zoom, we have Lepa Mladenovic.
Yes.
From Belgrade. Are you there, Lepa?
Yes. Do you hear me?
Welcome. Yes.
Do you hear you? Do. Can we see you too?
I think I was seeing you. Where did she go?
I see myself.
Okay, let's see. I'm gonna put gallery view for a second and let me make sure that we can still see the interpreter. Michelle, can we see Jenny? And Lepa?
Yep.
Okay,
perfect.
Lepa, welcome.
Welcome.
Welcome here. I want to, you know, you never know with Zoom, so I see you're here, and we invited you to say a few words about Alex Dobkin, because we think it's very significant that I started off by saying many of these women do or don't know what kind of impact they have, and for you to be impacted all the way around the world decades ago, we thought it was more important for you to talk about that. So please do, and I will try to pull up one of the songs that you asked for after you speak. Thanks, Lepa.
Oh, first I have to say, do you hear me? Yes.
Yes. Yes.
Well, I have to say I'm so impressed and moved by the first two fantastic women that you have told us a little bit about. And I think Alex Dobkin is on the line of the revolutionaries that you have already presented us, because for us who are lesbian feminists like me, she's part of our identity, you know, like of who we are, because she was one of the first a lesbian feminist who wrote, she's a song, singer, songwriter, who wrote about lesbians, and I will cite her. Her words are this. She said, in 1973, so a long time ago, I produced the ELP Lavender Jane Loves Women together with Kay Gardner and Marilyn Rees. And I believe that was the first album by lesbians, for lesbians, and about lesbians in the history of the world. From then on until now, I have focused on the lives and concerns and perspectives of women who love women. And I think it's very clear that if somebody concentrates on music, on loving women, that means she already knows she's not going to be a commercial star or commercial singer. You know, she was always concerned to sing for the lesbian community. And also what she said, another side thing is, I love being a lesbian. It's very self-affirming and courageous to be a lesbian and to say it out loud. So really, my story is that even though her first songs came out in 73 and 75, I live in East Europe, in Belgrade, which was once upon a time Yugoslavia. And so at the end of the 80s, 88, one of our friend lesbian was in New York, and so she brought a cassette which was reprinted from the original, so it wasn't even an original one, and then we reprinted in many copies in Belgrade. And we couldn't believe it. I tell you, when I first put her songs, there were so many times the word lesbian that the whole country of Yugoslavia never pronounced it so many times just on one album. You know, like, yeah, it's good to be a lesbian, lesbian. Oh, it's good to be a lesbian. And we used to hang out in my kitchen because at that time we did not have a lesbian group in Belgrade. So we used to meet in my kitchen, which we used to name Free Lesbian Republic, my little kitchen. And then we would put this cassette and sing with her and dance. And it was really a fantastic joy to feel free and to really construct. It was a part of the construction of who I am as a lesbian and who we are as a community, because all her songs were very positive songs about lesbian friendship and about lesbian partnership and love, and also about oneself, because really one of the most famous song is the best woman in you, the first woman in your life is you. You know, we always thought she's gonna sing a love song. The first woman in your life is your partner. No, no, no. It's each of us. This one is the song we used to sing many times. So this is really one more thing I want to say about her is that she was very active in the lesbian feminist community in Michigan, a women's festival in many, many years. She used to go there. And also in the last 20 years, before she died this year, she was active in OLOC, which is Old Lesbian Organized, Old Lesbian Organizing for Change. So that was really her last activities. She was an activist until the end of her life.
So Lip, I just want to say for people, just, you know, when you say like the word, you know, when the word came on the cassette, lesbian, 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 I just want to say for the, you know, maybe some of the younger people watching, that was unspeakable. That was unspeakable. And so for it came like for you, like a package, you know, like a little package, like a bottle across the sea.
Like a fusion, you know, we were like infusion, you know, like every day I would listen, I don't know, 10 times this cassette, you know, like today, you know, it's like you just replay because this was the first time we would hear out loud with proudness and with joy and with, you know, happiness, this word and the world of lesbians. And then we also very soon in 91, the war started in the country where I live. So I just continued to listen to these songs because it really connected me to the lesbian community, even though I didn't have much of the lesbian community where I lived by the time the war started. But I know that there is internationally a lesbian community, which then, you know, you sort of feel part of a lesbian community. And you cannot make a lesbian identity without other lesbians, because it's about
exactly.
You can be vegetarian in food, you know, and eat vegetables, that's fine, but you can't be a lesbian with other community, without a community. So it's a very particular identity, which really it's crucial to have a community. So her songs were part of this first community, even though we were only few in Belgrade, but with her songs, we were many, many more of the lesbians. And so we used to try to understand what she said, because at that time there was no internet and we didn't have words.
Right, yes. Right.
Yes.
Well, that, thank you,
Lev. Thank you so much. And thank you also for your history on behalf of women's rights and lesbian gay rights and just the protection and development of women and for the friendships that we have developed across the seas. And thank you very much for your legacy. You have an amazing legacy as well.
Which is also featured on Vox Femme.
Yes.
as well. So this is one of the songs that Lepa wanted us to play today from Alex Dobkin, who has passed away, who we're honoring today, that came across the sea and gave so much strength, speaking to the unspeakable at the time.
I'm sorry we don't have a line.
I heard Cheryl and Mary say there are two kinds of people in the world today. One or the other, a person must be. The men are them, the women are we. Second places in the Masters games. Oh, it's real as a mountain, it's strong as the sea. Besides, an angry woman is a beauty. She's a chosen to be a dyke like me, and she's a lesbian. Between us friends, oh no, will I see you again? Oh, when you're a lesbian,
lesbian, lesbian in no man's land. Lesbian, lesbian, any woman can be a lesbian.
Every woman can be a lesbian.
Thank you for Lepa, so much.
It's wonderful.
And thank you for joining us from Belgrade.
Yes, thank you so much.
Please promise we can do another, we're going to do another whole, we need to know, there's so much history, and please promise us that you'll return and we'll do another program.
Yes, we will. It's really wonderful. I adore you. You two are my heroines.
Oh, we adore you. Thank you.
The next amazing woman whose life we honor today is Gloria Richardson.
Gloria Richardson Dandridge, she was born in 1922. She was an American civil rights activist, best known as the leader of the Cambridge Movement, a civil rights struggle in the early 60s in Cambridge, Maryland, on the Eastern Shore. She was recognized as a major warrior in the civil rights movement at the time. She was one of the signatories to the Treaty of Cambridge, signed in July 1963, and she was instrumental in the passage of the Civil Rights Act of 1964. And she also raised issues regarding the role of women in the civil rights movement. An amazing woman. We're going to hear in her own words today. There is an interview, there's part of the interview here with Democracy Now with Amy Goodman. And she was invited to, after her work in Cambridge, she was invited to speak at the Civil Rights March, Dr. King's March. And she was given the microphone, and then she just got to say hello, and then the mic was taken away, and they were taken away, and she was not allowed to speak. So she was she speaks about that too. Are we ready?
Almost.
Oh, okay. So lots of room to grow and to look and auto-examine our movements and the role of women and sexism and how those things have to continue to change for us.
Even forward. Among the most like sacred cows, I think that's one of the things that has to be looked at, that there are a lot of sacred cows, even among progressive movements, that we have to be, have an autocritic.
You have to be able to move the pieces of the puzzle so that we can grow.
Yes. Okay.
Are you ready?
Is that good, Ishel?
Yes, everything looks great.
Why do you think this photo is so iconic?
I have no idea. Maybe because it was a woman pushing away a gun.
I refer to her as a silent warrior and a general. She didn't lead you in the wrong direction. She led you, I'm going to say, to the path of freedom.
Became known through our community as the leader of our civil rights movement, the mother, if you will.
Cambridge, Maryland was segregated, with Race Street dividing the blacks from the whites.
They had a restaurant right there called Disneyland. You couldn't go in there and sit down or get nothing.
She changed all of that, all of it.
She was different than most of the other leaders. She was a middle-aged woman. She was militant. She was savvy. She was from the community. She led a community-based movement. But because she's also different than the way we often think of the movement, we don't know that much about her.
This woman had passion. She had a plan. Plus, she wasn't alone. She had people backing her up to say, you can do it. I've got your back. I'm with you.
When this photo is taken, there had been weeks after weeks of protests in the streets.
Hundreds of people were on the other side of that picture in the background. We usually had something going on daily, demonstrations, marches, picketing. When we were out that day, we heard what I thought were bullets. And I was crossing to find out what had happened.
She defied the white power structure here. They had always expected the black leaders to hold the peace, hold the order. They're saying, okay, if you guys agree to call off your protests, we'll negotiate with you. And she said, no, you're not going to negotiate with us unless we're on the streets, unless we're marching.
Oh, I didn't believe in nonviolence if people would come and shooting into your houses.
Gloria worked the street, but she didn't work just Pine Street. Remember, she was all over the place. She was in Washington. She went to New York. She went down south. Women were definitely behind her, so she could take the lead, and the men saw the strength in her and followed her.
I think as much was achieved there as, say, in Birmingham, which gets a lot more, you know, press and media and historical attention.
When she spoke, people knew that she meant business and she was in charge.
It It was just people whose lives were at stake and in danger. And it was a life and death situation almost every day.
What a beautiful tribute and what an amazing legacy. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Yes.
Wow.
Gloria Richardson. And one of that's one of the, you know, as much as she was such a strong presence, many people that we were reading, people who spoke about her, and they said that she's one of the people that you don't hear about as much, and yet she was
unstoppable.
Moving movements along. The next amazing woman that passed recently is Nawal El Sadawi, and she died. She was born in October of 1931. And she passed away this March in 2021. She was an Egyptian feminist, writer, activist. She was a physician, a psychiatrist. She was, the common theme is just uncompromising, no fear of speaking the truth, no fear of speaking the words that others and others in power don't want you to speak. She wrote many books, and she also paid particular attention, she's a physician as well, to the practice of female genital mutilation. She was very controversial, often called, you know, one of the most dangerous and controversial women in Egypt. She helped to publish a feminist magazine in 1981 called Confrontation, no less, Confrontation. She was imprisoned by Egyptian President Anwar Sadat. And she said, I was arrested because I believed Sadat. He said it was a democracy and you can criticize. So I started criticizing. I landed in jail. But even in prison, she found a way to fight against oppression of women. She formed the Arab Women's Solidarity Association. This was the first legal and independent feminist group in Egypt. In prison, it was said that she was denied pen and paper. But she used a black eyebrow pencil and some toilet paper and kept on writing. So never give up. Never give up, never surrender.
Yes.
If you would.
Every time you hear her speak, you see her calmly just describe how some things are just unacceptable as human beings. One of the things that she fought against was the marriage of young girls. Some of her cousins were married at 10 years of age, and she was pushed to do the same, but she fought back, and her parents could not stop her either. So that's an amazing legacy. She traveled all over the world speaking these words, and there was no jail cell that was able to contain her spirit at all, and she lives on.
Ishel, it looks good?
Yep, looks great.
Feminism is not a Western invention. Feminism was not invented by American women, as many people think. No, feminism embedded in the culture and in the struggle of all women all over the world. We have to liberate women economically, socially, psychologically, physically, religiously.
So if our feminism, we called ourselves historical, that's the slogan of our group, historical socialist feminist. Because we studied history and we understood that the oppression of women is not specific of Egypt or Arab people. It is historical. It is everywhere in every country. Women were rebelling in all religions, in India, in Egypt, under Hinduism, under Judaism, under Christianity or Islam. Women were fighting for their rights. And we call ourselves socialist because we are against class oppression. We are against capitalism because capitalism is linked to patriarchy. We are against patriarchy, not men. We are not against men. We are against patriarchy, the patriarchal system, the domination of men in religion, in economy, in culture, in everything, in science. That's why we call ourselves historical socialist feminists. And
this organization terrified the men in power, didn't it?
Terrified, yes, of course. It terrified them. That's why they banned it. And in fact, we were about to create a revolution because we had 40% men. We had 40, we were not all women.
Men were joining too.
We had 40% men and young men, very enthusiastic about these points.
Why were they joining? Why were men joining?
Because they felt that men are oppressed by patriarchy too.
What amazing clarity. Yes, it's like, this is so amazing to be able to do Vox Femme because it's so empowering to see other women and their clarity.
Yeah.
and the way that they want to move things forward. And the question remains is like, why aren't these women like in power? Like, what is it that we need to continue to do to push through and have the clarity an historical stance that these women have. Speaking of which,
so Fikile Changase, South African environmental activist, and to answer one of the questions, why the strongest, some of these women are not in power, is that many of them are being murdered, many of them are being killed. In particular, many of you know about the incredible rise in killing of environmental activists in general, on one hand, men and women, and on the other hand, the femicides in many countries. So those two things are definitely a factor. And Fikile Changase was the leading member of a group, a community organization, the MCEJO, which advocated legal action against an open cast coal mine in her community, which is Somkele, and that happens to be near one of the oldest nature reserves in Africa, as well as being her community as well. And that coal mine is operated by Tendele Coal. There was a proposed expansion and she was fighting against it. And on October 22nd, 2020, she was killed by four gunmen in her home while she was preparing dinner. And we are still looking for this. We found a piece that is about her. We're still looking for some footage to add to the space of remembrance that maybe someone recorded of her speaking.
We are not only mourn the killing of these women, but we are outraged because it must stop. It's just, it was so clear that the mining was connected to her murder. Yet there is like an incredible web of bureaucracy that starts to make excuses for the use of land, the la usurpación de la tierra, mm-hmm. for these purposes. This is a video.
No one has lived in this house since Fikile Changase was murdered in October.
The 65-year-old environmental activist had opposed the expansion of one of South Africa's largest open coal mines in KwaZulu-Natal province. Her grandson told the police two men came to the gate at night and asked for water to drink.
One of the guys asked, where are the dogs? And he said, no, the dogs are there. He said, can you guys hold the dogs for us? So as the boys were holding the dogs, the guys, two guys or whatever guys, they came in and then they had the shot. And then he said, we had another shot and then we realized that it's the guns. Then they ran away to the next door.
Some of those in favor of the mine's expansion have condemned the killing, saying they and the mine owners had nothing to do with it.
To me, it was merely a work of hooligans, who must be arrested. Criminal act. Those people must just be arrested and rot in jail and let the law take its course. Because it's not going to help us to try that case in the public domain.
Officials at the Somkele coal mine say it's struggling and on the verge of closing down. That's why it needs to find new ground to keep operating. They say if they don't, they will have to fire some workers.
This is where the coal mine plans to expand to. It's about 5 kilometers from the original location. Most families have accepted a compensation deal and agreed to be relocated, but some are adamant they're not going anywhere.
Some families live very close to where the mine is operating and have been here for generations. It's where their ancestors are buried. Activists blame the mine for damaging the environment and people's homes and livelihoods. And some people say they should be compensated with amounts they believe reflect the value of the mine to its owners.
It's the only way we can stop the mining. That's why we're telling them about the millions and billions they have to pay. Because we know they're doing billions and trillions, but they never gave any 1 billion to the community.
There are claims and counterclaims about why Fikile Changase was killed and who did it. Until there are answers, mine officials say they'll push on with expansion plans. And those refusing to move say they'll carry on doing everything they can to stop that from happening. Haru Mutasa, Al Jazeera, Mpukunyoni, South Africa.
Wow. So for every woman, every space that we create on VoxFem for her, we're going to try to put updates on the work that they were doing. So, for example, the latest that we found on the case against the Tendele mining is that the mining company has won the latest round. And that link will be up there. But
they're
as always,
pushing people out of the area.
Yes. And as always, it creates division in the community as well. So we'll keep putting updates there and also updates on where different groups can connect, because that's really the point. We need to all connect with each other. There's this saying, think globally, act locally, and I can't stand that. I'm sorry if anybody out there made that up. I apologize, but I think we have to do both. I think we have to think globally, think locally, and act
and chew gum
at the same time. And I think it's imperative that, you know, these mega forces of, let's face it, destruction don't have a problem uniting and
they're really internationalists. They speak the language of money. So we have to speak the language of activism internationally as well.
Yes. So the next woman, that amazing woman that we want to honor,
is Priola Catherine Johnson. She was born in August 1918. Died in February 2020. She was an American mathematician whose calculations of orbital mechanics as a NASA employee were critical to the success of the first and subsequent U.S. crewed space flights. During the 33-year career at NASA, she earned a reputation for mastering complex manual calculations and helped pioneer the use of computers to perform the tasks. The space agency noted her historical role as one of the first African-American women to work as a NASA scientist. Her work included calculations, trajectories, launch,
windows and emergency return paths for Project Mercury space flights, including those for astronauts Alan Shepard, the first American in space, and John Glenn, the first American in orbit. I think we're going to share some of the...
Yes, and she was, I don't know if you said that, but I love that they called her the human calculator, and that one of the stories, and many people know this from Hidden Figures, but she, you know, they at the time they had the machines and the computers, and but they the astronauts
didn't trust the computers.
Said they literally said, get the girl, right? That's what how they referred to her. They said, go get her, because they knew she was the brains that would assure their safety, and in fact
it did.
So we are going to go. So.
Ms. Johnson, thank you so much for allowing us to be here from the American Geophysical Union to speak with you today. So I want to start with asking you, when did you first realize that you had such a love of math?
I must have been born with it. They said I counted everything going steps upstairs, steps to the church. Some of them I can still remember. 68 steps to the church.
As an African American and as at a woman, what advice are you able to give scientists and students today?
My father had taught me he was good as anybody here. And you as bad as anybody here. So just be yourself, but do your best at all times.
It's written that you have said that a great professor can teach you what you need to know, and yet they don't always help you get your career. We have a lot of students in the American Geophysical Union. What advice would you give those students so that they can have not just a great teacher, and yet also someone who will help them with their career?
I just always had the best teachers from high school on. And I had confidence in what they were teaching. I listened. I absorbed it, and I used their information. And I think you should be able to do that with anything that is being taught to you. Mm-hmm. Have confidence.
There's a story about you in graduate school where you were asking a lot of questions in class, and your professor was wondering why, because he knew you knew the answers.
He said, why that you're always asking me questions, and I know you know the answer. I said, but I can see that they didn't quite understand. You didn't make it as clear to them as it was to me.
If you were to start a career now, what other discipline of science are you interested in if you wanted to pursue something today?
Something else?
Yes, ma'am.
Not, there isn't anything else.
Oh my God, how amazing. How beautiful.
The complete and utter love for her field, and you know, there is nothing else.
There is nothing else.
Yes. So she broke through. I think we wrote that on there, that one of the other things we read about her is that she, you know, when they said, how did you break through so many obstacles in life? And she said, I took the problem out of the equation.
She just gave a beautiful mathematical answer.
Yes.
Amazing. We are now we are honoring Carmen Vasquez. She was a Puerto Rican activist, writer, community intellectual, a long time LGBTQ plus activist. She grew up in Harlem and she passed away recently at the age of 72. She spent many years in San Francisco. She was the founding director of the Women's Building and helped establish the Lavender Youth Recreation and Information Center. After graduating, Vasquez moved almost two decades, and she was a leading activist in causes ranging from immigrants' rights to lesbian health. She has left a legacy, and her life influenced many lesbian activists. She was a co-founder and co-chair of Somos Hermanas, a Central American women's solidarity network, returned to New York in 1994, where she continued her activist work as director of public policy for the LGBT Community Center from 94 to 2003. And I think we're gonna play an excerpt so we can hear her.
There's a civil rights frame in the United States that promotes equality, but I don't think it works. Equality is the floor, and justice is the goal. Equality is not justice. The concept of removing inequality and moving towards justice is hugely important to communities of color and to the lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender movement. So we recently had a huge victory. We have marriage equality, and that's great. It's something that we should have the right to choose. But it doesn't guarantee us that we will not be fired from our jobs. It doesn't guarantee access to the kind of health care that you need. It doesn't guarantee that our youth will not continue to be 40% of the homeless population. Discrimination against lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender people leads to many different kinds of inequality. It leads to lesbian, gay, transgender people being treated with hostility in the schools, being bullied, which then leads to them dropping out of the system, which then leads to them being on the streets. It means that in many, many, many states in this country, people are afraid they'll lose their jobs if they are open about their sexual orientation. It leads to older people not being able to get treated adequately in nursing homes. The notion of equality ends legal discrimination, but it doesn't do much to change hearts and minds. That's the struggle, that's the work that we still need to do. Equality is not where we need to stop. Justice is where we need to continue to move forward.
We honor you today. We love the clarity of her thinking and her figuring the problem out and not stopping at equality, but justice. It also, I love her clothing, her cross-dressing, an unapologetic stance in the world with her body, leading with her body, talk about intersectionality, looking at it. Love the expansive frame and the expansive beauty of the LGBTQ plus community, where we all have ways to provide solutions and for advancement and protection and survival. So thank you, Carmen Vasquez.
The final honoring for today is LaDonna Good Earth Woman Brave Bull Allard. She is was Native and still is. I feel like all of these people are present tense. Native American, Dakota, Lakota historian, genealogist, and she is a matriarch of the Water Protector movement. In April of 2016, many people know about the massive resistance movement against the Dakota Access Pipeline, which was she lent her land to those encampments as well, and which is at the Standing Rock Indian Reservation in North Dakota. After years of resistance and protest, the Standing Rock Sioux Tribe and the movement scored a legal victory on June 6, 2020, when a federal judge ordered the pipeline owner, the Energy Transfer Partners, and the founder, we like to name these people as well, Kelsey Warren, to stop operations and empty the pipelines of all oil pending an environmental review that could take a year. The court said the U.S. Army Court of Engineers violated national environmental law, and it failed to produce an adequate environmental impact statement. So that was a victory. And there are victories, and anybody knows this who's been in movements. What gets created, even if the outcome at that moment is not in your favor, we're in it for the long haul. So all the created energy, the relationships that were created, the learning that happens, all that was created as well. The fight continues. I'm saying that because the fight goes on. As of a few days ago, and we put the link on her page, they have started up again. So there is a new fight there with DAPL. And many of you also know about many of the other pipeline fights as well, but we'll keep putting up light updates there. Just saying that because many people know about the victory and they don't know that sometimes it takes the spotlight off and the fight there is not over. So we will, this is the space for LaDonna. And just give me one moment here.
We thank you for joining us today. And to share with us this moment of honoring these amazing women. Thank you really so much for joining us. It gives us all a sense of solidarity. We're not alone. And we have been and will be here for the long haul. They may have everything else, but we have each other.
Yes.
And we must continue that.
That was September 3rd. And for me, that's always a hard day for us because that's the day of the Whitestone Massacre. And I was standing there thinking, is this what my grandmother went to when they shot her? My grandmother was shot at that massacre. Everybody else died. She lived. Is this what they felt when those dogs came? Is this what they felt when the soldiers came that early morning? And so it was really a overwhelming day, and people were just crying everywhere. It was really hard to watch that, really hard to watch them tear up that earth. Who does that? What kind of human beings do that? Who would go just to disturb a grave? I can't comprehend why people would have that amount of hatred in their heart. There were three police cars, and the policemen were standing on the road, and I know I was a little upset, so I walked over there and I said, why didn't you do something? And the policeman told me, we're only here to control the traffic in the road. And the next day, when I listened to that report from the sheriff of Morton County, he said the police were not there. They said that we attacked the dogs. Nothing about the dogs attacking us. This company came and attacked us with dogs and pepper spray. I think they were like trying to provoke us into something. I have to say that I'm really proud of our people because I seen a lot of women crying, but I seen people praying. I seen people singing. I seen people doing the best they could in that kind of situation. And yet the papers don't talk about this. The people don't talk about this. It is, those Indians are harming those dogs. Going back to this river, my son is buried over there. So how can I allow this? I know these relatives up on the hill, you know, they are of other tribes. That doesn't give anybody any right to destroy them. Here, this is my son, and I can't allow it. I don't think it's about Standing Rock. I think it's about the world. I think it's about everybody. I think there's something more. I think it's this time and space. It's not about just Standing Rock. It's about every place that's fighting right now. Fighting for the water. The water is important to everybody. And that's how I kind of look at this is, oh my God, it's at everybody's back door. There's nobody that's being left out of this. We have to stand up if we're going to live. We have to stand up so that our grandchildren can live. So it's more than just Standing Rock.
Get up, stand up. Stand up for your right.
So we want to thank you again, and we want to just tell you very quickly that everything you saw today, we'll try to make it, it will be up on YouTube after this. It will be on voxfem.org, so that's voxfem.org. That's where everything is. And every event in this festival, this is the opening of a festival, every event is different. They're hybrid creative events. Tomorrow, beautiful, beautiful. All of them are at 1 p.m. Central Time on Facebook Live, and there's a Zoom link as well for some of them, but always Facebook Live. Tomorrow, for sure, not to be missed. Of course, if you can't see it at 1 o'clock, you can see it later. That's Mona Susan Power, Leanne Howe, and Ernestine Hayes will be reading and have a brief conversation with each other, and it is
stunning.
It's
amazing.
I won't put words. I'll let them have the words.
They have the words.
Thank you very much.
Gracias.
Thank you, Jenny, Blake, so much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Lepa, for participating. Thank you, all of you who are here with us. And join us for the rest of the festival, August 13th through the 20th. And always come back to voxfem.org. Thank you, Red Salmon Arts, who is our nonprofit sponsor, Long History of Resistance, and to the Alice Kleberg Reynolds Foundation, the sponsor, to Ishel Cuellar for helping us, and also to resist.org, who is sponsoring the sign language and captioning. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Oh, bravo. Revolution now.